Today, I am going to discuss about groundwater exploration. Or selection of sites for water wells. The successful method of searching the groundwater is called as groundwater exploration. Groundwater does not occur everywhere below the earth's surface. As it is occurring beneath the soil, direct checkup is not possible. Hence, suitable studies are very much required for searching the groundwater successfully. Otherwise, time, money, and energy spent may become useless. There are three scientific methods of investigation can be seen. They are, number one, geological method, number two, hydrological method, number three, geophysical method. Number one, geological method. Number two, hydrological method. Number three, geophysical method. Let us take one by one. The first one is geological method. What is geological method? Why it is important? It is the most important and main deciding factor in groundwater exploration. The other two methods, which are particularly hydrological method and geophysical methods, provide only supplementary information. Geological investigation takes place under the following steps. Number one, by studying the topography of the area, we can assess whether the area is consisting of water molecules or not. The first one, topography. Second one, rainfall. And climate. Number three, geology of the area. Number four, porosity and permeability. Number five, joints and faults. Number six, the study of folds. Number seven, vegetation. Number seven, vegetation. Number eight, proximity of any water bodies. Like lakes, rivers, channels, reservoirs, etc. Number 9, study of wells in the neighborhood regions. These 9 parameters are essential to understand the geological method. Geological investigation takes place under these 9 properties. Let us take one by one. The first one, study of topography. What is topography? Topography refers to the relief features of the land, that is hills, valleys and level ground. The water table will be roughly parallel to the topography of that particular region. If the terrain is mountain, the water table is also in the form of mound shaped structure. If the terrain is level ground, the water table is also parallel to the surface. If the terrain is valley, the water table is also appears in the form of valley shaped structure. The water table, this is the water table, this is the ground surface, see, hill station, level ground, valley region. The water table, this is the water table, generally occurs relatively higher in hill regions. You see here, the distance between the surface to the water table is always higher than level ground and valley region. And at valley regions, this water table is always very close to the ground surface. If the surface has a steep slope, most of the rainfall when precipitation takes place on this terrain, definitely the water which will be reached to the ground surface, definitely that takes place quick movement on the surface, which means surface runoff is very high at the hill station and steep slope regions. But when we come to the level ground, first, when precipitation takes place, the water gets entered into the ground through the surface, after which only some amount of water takes place, surface runoff, which means runoff will be very high at the hill station and steep slope regions, and very little here, very little water undergoes percolation. The groundwater flows from different sides to the point. But when we come to the level ground, what happens? The precipitated water enters into the ground through the surface. After the saturation of these voids, which means which are present in this particular region, then the surface runoff takes place. The water which takes place surface runoff, then it will move towards the low-lying area. The groundwater flows from different sides to that particular point. When water stands a prolonged period of time here, which comes from all the reasons, what happens? The water gets entered into the ground through the surface when it stands prolonged period of time. More amount of water when stays in this valley region, more amount of water gets entered into the water table through infiltration and percolation. Therefore, the valley region is more favorable for seeking wells than the slopes and hill stations. By studying the topography, we can come to the conclusion which site is suitable for seeking the groundwater. According to our geological knowledge, by studying relief features, comparatively hill, level ground and valley region, the valley region is very suitable to seek the groundwater when we compare with tops of the hills as well as steep slopes or even gentle slopes. The second point is study of rainfall and climate. By studying rainfall and climate, which climate is suitable for seeking the groundwater can be assured. In regions with a humid climate, which means there will be less evaporation. When precipitation takes place, the region which is composed of humid climate, there will be less evaporation and high percolation. Whereas in places of hot and dry, which means arid climate, there will be high evaporation. When evaporation is high, definitely there will be less percolations. Therefore, regions having good rainfall and a humid climate will have good groundwater potential. And naturally, regions with little rainfall, which means scanty rainfall and arid climate, will have low groundwater potential. The next point is geology of the area. By studying geology of the area, we can come to the conclusion whether the area is suitable to seek the groundwater. The area which is consisting of thick soil or alluvium cover or highly weathered rocks denote good storage of groundwater. The regions comprising of igneous rocks, metamorphic rocks and impervious shales in sedimentary rocks denote lack of groundwater, paucity of groundwater. The regions, particularly igneous rocks like granite or even dolerite, whatever the rocks, when there is no fractures or flaws or whatever the joints, definitely on which when precipitation takes place, that water does not able to enter into the groundwater table through the surface. When the rock is devoid of flaws, when the rock is devoid of fractures, when the rock is devoid of joints, definitely the precipitated water takes place surface runoff. There is no voids, there is no joints, there is no cracks, there is no flaws. The massive rock, whatever, whether it may be igneous or metamorphic or sedimentary, definitely when precipitation takes place on that particular terrain, that water does not able to enter into the groundwater table through that surface. The areas of thick soil When the area is composed of a thick soil, the precipitated water gets entered into the soil very quickly. The soil is majorly composed of pores. Pores means interstices. Interstices means openings. When these openings are going to receive the water molecule, definitely that takes place vertical movement towards the groundwater table after its saturation. What is alluvium cover? The soil which has been transported by the freshwater bodies are called by the name alluvium soil. That soil has more voids. When precipitation takes place on that particular terrain, more amount of water gets entered into the soil very quickly. That soil is rich with sand particles that contains more amount of voids. When that terrain receives precipitation, more amount of water gets entered into the soil, which is called by the name infiltration. After the infiltration, that water which enters into the ground takes place vertical movement, which is called by the name percolation. Such a way the water reaches to the groundwater table. That's why by studying geology of the area, we can able to assess whether the area is composed of water molecules or not. By studying geology of the area, like soil, soil thickness, what kind of soil it is, and what kind of rock it is, whether the rock is composed of flasks, fractures, joints, we can come to the conclusion whether the area is suitable to seek the groundwater or not. The next property is porosity and permeability. The occurrence of groundwater in a geological formation depends on the porosity and permeability properties of that formation. Porosity is described as the amount of openings present in a geological unit, which means empty spaces present in that particular geologic unit, which is expressed the ratio of total number of voids to the total volume of sample, whatever it is, which is always expressed in percentage also. Permeability is the ability of the rock to transmit the water through it. That is, permeable rocks allow the water to pass through them. This property of the rock is due to the interconnected voids, porosity, due to the interconnected voids present in the rock, which means pores are interconnected. Pores must be interconnected. When the pores are interconnected, that is called by the name permeability. Permeability is dependent on the porosity character of the rock. In other words, only porous rocks are permeable, which means when there is no pores in geologic unit, definitely there is no permeability. If it is composed of pores, then only we can able to anticipate permeability. If the pores are present, then only they can able to interconnect with each other. If there is no permeability, only in geologic unit, when we are going to find pores, definitely that cannot able to provide the water. Thus, highly porous and permeable rocks are going to encourage storage of groundwater. In addition to that, the dip direction of bedding planes influences the flow of groundwater beneath the surface. Totally, porosity and permeability, which is togetherly called by the name aquifer. when a geologic unit can able to hold the water and yield the water. To hold the water, that must be composed of pores. To yield the water, these pores must be interconnected. Very simple. The fourth property, porosity and permeability, is nothing but an aquifer. Aquifer means which has the capacity to hold the water through its pores, which has the capacity to yield the water through its interconnection of voids, interconnection of openings, which is also called by the name pathways. By studying porosity and permeability, we can come to the conclusion whether the area is suitable or not to seek the groundwater. The next property is the fifth one, the study of joints and faults. By studying joints and faults, we can come to the conclusion whether the area is suitable or not to seek the groundwater. If well-developed joints are present in any kinds of rocks, that influences the movement of groundwater along their alignment. The presence of joints, cracks, faults, even in the massive rocks, stores a sufficient quantity of groundwater. Similarly, if faults present, influences the groundwater to move along them. For example, if the rock is massive, if the terrain is massive, you see, if it is the terrain, when there is no joints, when there is no flaws, when it is massive, when precipitation takes place on this particular terrain, definitely that does not able to take place movement towards the groundwater table through this massive rock. When there is no flaws, when there is no joints, when there is no fractures, definitely this precipitated water does not get entered into this terrain. If it is composed of number of joints, number of flaws through which the water can able to enter into the ground. That's why by the presence of joints, we can anticipate the groundwater in any kind of terrain, whether it may be igneous terrain or sedimentary terrain or metamorphic terrain. That's why the study of joints are also another important criteria to seek the groundwater in any terrain. But when the same rock mass is subjected to faulting, what happens? One rock, one block has to be moved upward, another block has to be moved downward. You see? This is the fault plane. When precipitation takes place on this particular terrain through this fault plane, through this gap, water gets entered into the ground. Afterwards, that will be moved towards the groundwater table. The next property is the study of faults. What are faults? Faults are undulations in the rock beds. How the faults are formed? When a rock bed is subjected to lateral compressive force, then the anticlinal faults or synclinal faults can be seen. When the rocks are folded into anticlines and synclines, for example, this is anticlinal fold and this is synclinal fold. when the rock is in horizontal manner, in this format, what happens? The rock denotes even compactness. When this rock is subjected to lateral compressive force, then that produces either anticlinal fold or synclinal fold. Here, the rocks at the crustal region are fragmented. The rocks are at the trough region are also fragmented. Fractured, which means here also rocks are fractured, here also rocks are fractured. When precipitation takes place on both the terrain, what happens? Some amount of water gets entered into the ground through the fractured rock masses. The rest of the water takes place quick runoff on the surface. Because here that denotes gentle slope. When precipitation takes place on gentle slope, the water takes place sudden movement towards low-lying area. When that water stores here, what happens? Here also rocks are fragmented. Through this fragmentation, the stored water gets entered into the ground, after which water takes place vertical movement towards the groundwater table. That means when the rocks are folded into anticlines and synclines, the synclines are more favorable for storage of groundwater. The next property is the seventh one, which is vegetation. By studying vegetation of the area, the groundwater condition can be assessed. Basically, there are two kinds of vegetation. One is xerophytes, another one is preautophytes. By studying xerophytes and preautophytes, we can come to the conclusion whether the area can able to provide substantial amount of water or not. Some plants can exist on bald hillocks by extracting water, which means moisture, from vadose zone. What is vadose zone? Vadose zone means zone of aeration. The water which is present in the zone of aeration is called by the name suspended water or vadose water. Some plants can exist on bald hillocks by extracting moisture from vadose zone, and extracted water is stored in their thick fleshy leaves and stems. Such plants are called xerophytes. These xerophytes are going to extract the water from the zone of aeration. Xerophytes. The plants which are going to extract the water from this zone, that will be stored in their thick fleshy leaves and stems. Trees of the forest can able to extract the water directly from the zone of saturation. Trees are going to extract the water from this zone. Water which is present in this zone is called by the name vadose water. Water which is present in this zone is called by the name phreatic water. Trees of the forest can exist by extracting water directly from this zone of saturation, are phreatic zone. Such trees are known as phreatophytes. What is the difference between xerophytes and phreatophytes? Xerophytes are going to extract the water from the zone of aeration in this zone. Phreatophytes are going to extract the water which is present below the zone of aeration, which means at the deeper depth from zone of saturation. The water which is present in this zone is called by the name Vados water. The water which is present in this zone is called by the name phreatic water. Thick vegetation like forest indicate enormous storage of groundwater at considerable shallow depth. The terrain on which we are going to find thick vegetation or forest, they are going to extract the water directly from the zone of saturation, which is phreatic water. Thick vegetation like forest indicate enormous storage of groundwater at considerable shallow depth. Whereas bald hillocks with large number of xerophytes indicate the scarcity of groundwater at shallow depth. The absence of phreatophytes suggests there is a deficiency of groundwater in that particular region. The groundwater condition can be assessed. If the terrain is composed of phreatophytes, that provides substantial amount of water. If the terrain is composed of enormous amount of xerophytes, definitely that denotes paucity, which means lack of groundwater. The next point is proximity of any water bodies. Like rivers, lakes, tanks, channels, reservoirs, etc. Study of particularly surface water bodies. Proximity of any water bodies like lakes, rivers, tanks, channels, springs, whatever the water bodies, these water bodies must be surface water bodies. This refers to the occurrence of water bodies like lakes, rivers, ponds, channels, tanks, reservoirs, etc. In that particular region, the area around these water bodies get water due to influence of seepage. How the area gets that water due to infiltration and percolation. Nearer to these water bodies, wells are successful and yield water throughout the year. But wells are away from such water bodies may become poor healers. When a well is nearer to the above said water bodies, those wells can able to get the water through the influence of seepage. The last point, which is the ninth point, study of wells in the neighborhood regions. Study of wells in the neighborhood regions. The depth of water table, for example, there is a landmass. We have to seek the groundwater for this particular terrain. On the contrary, another landmass which is adjacent to this terrain, there is a well. By studying the depth of water table and yield of the well can be assessed by observing the static water level in the wells of the neighborhood regions. The subsurface geology and rock formation can be observed in the existing wells when the existing well becomes open well. However, care should be taken that no dikes or sills or faults are situated in between the existing wells and the proposed well. The static water level becomes 10 meters from the ground surface. In this well also we can able to anticipate the static water level will be the 10 meters from the ground surface. In case when there is no dikes or sills or fault planes are situated in between existing well as well as proposed well. If there is a dike between the existing well and proposed well, what happens? When this dike does not denote any fractures or flaws, definitely one area can able to provide the water, another area cannot able to provide the water. This acts as barrier to the one well. The water which will be stored in this terrain that does not able to takes place movement towards this region. It acts as barrier unless it is fractured. If it is fractured, definitely through the fracturedness, the water can able to move towards this region also. That's why care should be taken. No dikes or sills or faults are situated in between the existing well as well as proposed well. By studying neighborhood wells of that particular region, the depth of water table and yield of the well can be assessed by observing the static water levels in the wells of the neighborhood region.